You see, when we talk about connecting with the Indian Ocean or within Indian Ocean region, then we don't really talk only about blue economy or maritime security. It's a larger construct. And within that construct, in fact, we also deal with our maritime security issues, because I don't think if I say, you know, Indian Ocean is basically the lifeline for us, it would not be an exaggeration. And when it is a lifeline, you are supposed to make sure that your lifeline is safe and is not under any threat or challenge from anywhere. Indian Ocean, as this morning Admiral Dhawan was trying to spell out, it is a long, long history, in fact, going back to the old times when we didn't have the steam power to push our big vessels and ships. Indian Ocean, in fact, I'm sure you people here, you have naval background, so you know that much more than I know. Indian Ocean is different from other places in terms of it has very specific cycle, the current cycle, which we call monsoon. Now, monsoon, if those who know the oceanic currents, monsoons are so predictable. Monsoons are so predictable that they allowed you to travel along the entire coast of Indian Ocean without even the support of what is called the steam power later on. Because they move from one direction to the other for a particular period, and then they turn back and move to the other direction for a particular period. So much so that, in fact, when the Portuguese were trying to approach the Indian subcontinent, they didn't understand the monsoon dynamics for navigation. And when they turned around the Cape of Good Hope, then they handed over their ships to the Arab navigators who understood the monsoon currents and their dynamics, and they traveled from Kenya. You were in Kenya, isn't it?
Yes,
they traveled from Kenya to Goa in those days in state about 28 days, if my memory goes right. Now, in 28 days without any steam power to navigate that distance in those days was amazing. In fact, and it was the monsoon current which made that possible. And what happened with that? With that, in fact, for ages, I'm sure you have, Admiral Dhawan mentioned about Kalingas. Now, Kalingas in those days were a seafaring society, in fact. They were going all over, in fact. Even today, they celebrate something called Bali Yatra, where in a particular month, they have those tiny boats which they leave into the ocean, assuming that the monsoon winds will take them to Bali, right? And then the traders, after doing their trading and etc., will come back, and they could predict that that's the time they will come back. That was the beautiful part of the Indian Ocean. And this connected the ocean. This connected the ocean economically, culturally, linguistically. So there were a lot of exchanges. And this was a very integrated ocean, in fact, because of the monsoons which allowed that to happen. And as a result, you travel along the Indian Ocean coast, you find a huge Indian footprint. There is a crossbreeding of ideas, civilizational values in the region. And it was a very integrated region. For example, if you go to Southeast Asia, you travel, you find, you know, Buddhist temples, Buddhist ideas, Hindu temples, Hindu ideas. You go the other side, you have, you know, old time the Gujarati traders will travel all over the world and carry products and bring them back. Now, what happened thereafter, in fact, when the European powers came to the Indian Ocean, now they were foreign to the land or to the region, in fact. They didn't have that history. They didn't have that history of over 3,000, 4,000 years, which connected the region. They were alien to that process. They thought this was only a trading zone. This only meant business. This only meant money. And as a result, the Indian Ocean, that connectivity, that Indian Ocean concept of a family started disintegrating. And as a result, you know, we, instead of our old history of knowing each other, we became, in a way, strangers to each other. And that resulted in a lot of other conflicts in the region. Instead of trading, we started fighting in many places. So this was, in fact, the period when the Western powers, especially the Europeans, even, in fact, the Romans knew the monsoon. They knew how to negotiate monsoons. In the process, from that time later on, even they lost, you know, that idea of monsoons and came here and it was a stranger to them. Now the issue is that after independence, now several decades, we had to again come to grips with, because India is the major player in the Indian Ocean region. We are the lead player in the Indian Ocean region. If you look at the Indian Ocean map, you see why I'm saying that, right? Because the other major powers would not really compare unless we go to extraterritorial powers, be the Americans or still the Europeans, or even the Chinese are trying to come into the Indian Ocean. But if you look at the resident powers of the Indian Ocean region, then India is the lead power there. And we have to again think how to really, you know, get back to that process of regional integration so that we do not really look at each other only from a narrow, siloized view of the region. And we were, in fact, quite a major influence in reviving the whole concept of IORA. And I still remember I was in Delhi when we had a major first conference of IORA in Delhi, just to remind people that this is a region which has a long history of working together and not really working against each other. And thereafter, we had a Indian Secretary General, the first one, and stayed for quite some time there. He stayed there for almost 5 years, Ambassador Bhagirath. And then we started looking at the tools, how to engage them, because our idea was, because this morning the concept Sagar was mentioned, and we were just discussing here the origin of Sagar. I will not go into that origin because there is a bit of a anecdote which prevents me from going into that story. But the fact remains, I was in Mauritius, and Mauritius is the whole, like I say, our lifeline is ocean. If in India's case the lifeline is ocean, then can you imagine Mauritius? Their whole lifeline, their whole life is ocean, right? In our case, it's lifeline, but in their case, it's the life. The whole life is ocean. They live on ocean 24/7. So for them, the ocean is the boon, and the ocean is the bane both. So when I was there, and they were amongst the leaders of that small island state, developing states, SIDS as we call them. These countries, in fact, took this idea of blue economy, because we're already talking about green economy, in fact. Right, we're talking about greening the economy. And they said, all right, greening means what? Greening means you are just kind of touching up the whole process of economic development and keeping the pollutants a bit under check. But that was not enough, right? That was not enough. And when it comes to global warming per se, global warming is not really, doesn't fit into the traditional pollution control mechanism. It's not really, it's a result, it's not really a pollution in itself, right? So they said, you know, you're not touching the main aspect of ocean development. And that what they wanted to tell was that in case the global warming continues, then their very existence could be threatened by the rising sea waters or by the turbulence in their behavior or flooding or whatever. So they were very worried. And I still remember in those days, some of the countries preparing contingency plans of finding some other place to live in case their islands were to be threatened by the ocean's aggressive behavior, right? Or rising water levels. They started talking about this blue economy, which is basically an ecosystem-driven approach to ocean development. It is much more than the green way of developing oceans, much more than how we have always dealt with oceans, unless, you know, we go back to the Indian mythological approach to the ocean, when we say ocean is also a devata, and as a result you have to treat ocean with respect. But treating ocean with respect is one thing, but then do we understand what is that respect? What that respect would entail is a very, very technical issue, because you need to understand the ocean ecosystem for ensuring that the ecosystem is not disturbed. Because most of the time on the land we deal with aspects which are very visible to us. We touch them, we see them, we feel them, right? Whereas ocean is still an unknown entity. You can't really see what's happening inside there. In fact, according to the best estimates, I think we understand about 6% of the ocean. Now, can you imagine 94% of the ocean is not even understood by us? And almost 85-86% of the biological diversity on the earth is in the ocean. Now, how to deal with it, you know? And that is where the SIDS, in fact, the small island developing countries, they came up with this idea of blue economy, that our action with the ocean should be driven by our knowledge about the ocean. And therefore, in fact, the blue economy, in fact, most of the time I mention that sometimes very liberally use this term called knowledge economy. We very often say, oh, India is a knowledge economy, right? We are driven by knowledge. But come blue economy, we would really understand and know what really a knowledge-driven system is all about. It's going to be extensively driven by knowledge, and our knowledge is limited right now, right? Our knowledge is limited. For example, there is a place, I'm sure, again, people with a naval background would know. There is a phenomena which is in the Pacific, the Latin American coast of Pacific Ocean. It's called El Nino. Now, El Nino is a phenomena where there is a particular region of the Pacific Ocean where the temperature rises by 0.5 degrees centigrade. And when the average temperature rises by 0.5 degrees, it could be slightly more also, but that is where it triggers El Nino. 0.5 degrees above the normal, and they say it has triggered El Nino. And I was, in fact, in Peru long ago as a young officer. And there was indication that El Nino might trigger this year, right? And I started getting calls from India to study the phenomena and advise back home what was El Nino. And I was, as a young officer, oh, come on, for God's sake, you know, it's so far away. It's something about 15 to 18,000 kilometers. There are other oceans in between. And if El Nino is taking place, why are you worried, right? Is a 0.5 degree average temperature increase in the Pacific Ocean? Why are we worried? Then I learned that when El Nino takes place, we have drought in India. Can you imagine? 0.5 degrees rise in average temperature, far off place in the Pacific, and it can cause drought in the subcontinent. Now that is the complexity of this whole process. When I say knowledge, means we haven't even touched the knowledge which drives blue economy. And if I go to the biodiversity, it's much more complex yet, right? It's much more complex yet. We do not know how those living organisms behave, what their life cycle is, what their reactions are to temperature rise and all that stuff. In fact, Miller mentioned that if we don't control, there'll be more plastic in the ocean than fish. But if the temperature rises, who knows, there may be no fish in the waters. So we have to really be very careful, because as the temperature rises, the fish will move. The fish is going to move out of those zones. Now, if we have a certain fish reserves in our part of the ocean, just imagine if the temperature rises, they will not stay there. They will simply go away. And there's another, you must be wondering why I'm giving these examples, just to sensitize, you know, the mind. There was, in fact, a town. It was a fishing town. I won't name the place because it's the story which is more important than the place, in fact. So there was a town. It was called the Ghost Fishing Town. And I inquired, I said, why it's called Ghost Fishing Town? And the story goes like this. Just again to emphasize the knowledge part of this and the sensitivity of this whole thing. There was an island very close to the coast, big island, and this island used to attract a lot of birds, millions of birds. And when those birds will come, those birds will drop their droppings, right? Part of this on the island, part of this in the ocean water. And since there were millions of them, and there were millions of kilos of those droppings, right? And they were using those droppings for converting them into organic fertilizer. Which this is probably one of the best qualities of fertilizers, incidentally. Nitrogen fertilizer, bird droppings are the best nitrogen fertilizer. So there was a factory which was collecting that stuff, converting into packaging, and then selling this as organic fertilizer. Now when the droppings used to fall in the water, it will increase the organic content of the water, with which, in fact, there will be a lot of planktons coming to that region of water, and these planktons will attract more fish, right? So they will fish from the water. So they were fishing from the water, they were converting the droppings into fertilizer, and then the birds will attract tourists. Millions of tourists will come just to watch those birds. So can you imagine, there were three industries going on. Tourism was going on, fertilizer industry was going on, and then the fishing industry was going on, right? And then, you know, one fine year, as Mahatma Gandhi says, there is enough for need but not for greed. There was this greed which took over, and they said, can we not do a bit more of fishing? If you fish 10% more, what the harm, right? And they started fishing a little more. And then they breached the limit of the ecosystem. When they breached the limit of the ecosystem, suddenly the birds stopped coming because there was no fish which they were, the size of the fish which they used to feed on, they fished it. And as a result, the birds stopped coming. When the birds stopped coming, the droppings went away. When the droppings went away, the fertilizer plant went away. With the droppings not falling into the water, the organic content went away. With the organic content going away, the fish went away. And with the birds going, the tourists went away. Now, can you imagine a little mistake where you didn't know when you were crossing that limit resulted in all these industries disappearing and the town was called Ghost Town? Now, if we do not want to convert many of our coastlines into ghost coastlines, I think we have to be very careful we don't breach those limits of the ecosystem. And that is why, in fact, probably there will be a separate presentation which I had offered to speak on. That is called the marine spatial planning, right? We are aware of what is called the integrated coastal zone management. But marine spatial planning graduates from pure, you know, kind of management approach to the ecosystem, to the ecosystem-based approach to the management, right? So that is the difference between the integrated coastal zone management to the marine spatial planning. And that is what probably, you know, I keep sensitizing people that time, we are already late. In fact, we need to switch to marine spatial planning rather than doing pure integrated coastal zone management, because we do not know when we will cross that critical limit and we will be into trouble. Coming back to Indian Ocean now. Indian Ocean, as I said, we are the prime movers in the region, and our lifeline being Indian Ocean, we have to ensure that this region is secure, is safe from both the conventional and the non-conventional threats. Now, if you ask me, really, it's because those in the Navy will probably not agree with me. It is my belief that it is easier to handle conventional threats, and it is much more difficult to handle unconventional threats. Conventional threats are more predictable in a sense, and are more better manageable than the unconventional threats. And most of the time, other than maybe, you know, the Gulf Wars, when we had the conventional warfare in the Indian Ocean, by and large, the Indian Ocean has not faced conventional naval threats after the Great Wars. It is a non-conventional threat, be it piracy, be it terrorism, be it the whole climate change and ocean's health issues, in fact. These are all non-conventional threats to the ocean. And as I mentioned in the morning, because sometimes we feel, sitting, for example, in Delhi, we say, oh, so what? The ocean is polluted. My Yamuna is not polluted, right? So I can live with it. So ocean is very far. It's about 1,300 kilometers away. So I can be a bit, you know, disengaged from that phenomena and ignore it. But the fact is, when the critical limit in the ocean is exceeded, it will not impact only ocean. It will impact the land. In fact, the whole monsoon I talked about, the whole monsoon cycle may be impacted if the ocean's health is not kept under check. Because all these things depend on how the ocean behaves. Now, if the ocean's own behavior changes, then we will not be able to be confident about. In fact, there was a time when we were young, we could say, oh, on 3rd June or 3rd May, I don't remember now, on 3rd May, the monsoon must hit Kerala coast. So precise was this, can you imagine? Right? And today when we see, oh, 3rd to chala gaya, 13th aa gaya, chalo 23rd ko aa jayega. Right? So already we are seeing disruption of that predictability of monsoon. And the quantity, the spread, all those things are being affected. And if we cross that threshold, and just imagine if it gets further impacted, we might be impacted on land. It's the water cycle on land which really will hold us, to a critical situation. Now, what do we do? What do we do, in fact, for making sure that this lifeline is safe? And the Indian way of looking at things, I think the only sustainable way to making sure that the lifeline of Indian Ocean for us is safe is through cooperation. There are, you can eliminate threats only by two ways. One is by aggression and the other is by friendship. And my belief, very strong belief, is that aggression is not an answer. You cannot defeat each and every enemy of yours by aggression, but you can definitely win over your enemies through friendship. And that was the approach to Indian Ocean, which in fact we started developing and then started promoting through IORA. And what do we do, in fact? In that approach, that's a comprehensive package. What do we do for ensuring that we have friends and we don't have enemies in the region? And more friends you have, more stability you have in your backyard. We do it, as I said, in a very comprehensive manner, because being the largest country, we also had advantage in terms of technology, we had advantage in terms of skills, we had advantage in terms of higher education and all that stuff. And also development, capacity and development partnership. So we, in fact, try all these tools for making sure that we have friends and not foes in the region. We do a lot of capacity building through our various programs called the iTech program, the scholarship program, and so on and so forth. In fact, you would be surprised that under the ICCR, in fact, gives something about 5,000 to 6,000 scholarships every year, in fact, to candidates from this region. And Prime Minister announced that we will take it to 50,000 scholarships, in fact. Now, just imagine, if you start giving 50,000 productive scholarships to young students from the region, they will grow up to become their leaders. And once they grow up to become their leaders, they will not really hurt a friend who helped them educate. So one is this, where we do skill development. Then under the ITIC program, which is a short-term program, and we impart skills, we give almost 15,000 slots every year. Now, this, again, is a very large number. And then, in fact, we do actual development partnership through lines of credit and through grants to these countries. In fact, over the last about 10 years, the cumulative lines of credit which India has offered to other developing countries, mainly in this region, neighboring countries and Africa or Indian Ocean region, is about $24 billion. It's not a small amount. You see, for a developing country to allocate something about $24 billion for development assistance to other developing countries is not really a small contribution. Then we do a lot of, as this morning, I don't know whether the ones have mentioned about India being net security provider in the region, though I sometimes not use that term. We provide security to many of our partners in the region. I was in Mauritius. I'm sure you have heard about Seychelles, Mauritius, Sri Lanka, Maldives. You name it, all those small countries, whenever they need support in terms of real security of their waters, we do a lot of support programs with them, starting from the surveys of their waters to the provision of hardware for their coastal security and training of their Coast Guard people and other people. That is within this all. What I am saying is part of our approach to IORA, building bridges with them. So we do a lot of civilian work, we do capacity building work, we also do a lot of security work with them. Then it provides us the opportunity to kind of create what is called ocean governance systems. And if you are a party to the creation of ocean governance systems, then you can make sure that the regulation is such that which protects your interests. I can go on and on, but I think I will stop at some stage. I thought I have really given you a broad picture of what is the need and compelling reason for building bridges with our partners in the Indian Ocean, because it is in a long-term interest. We would want to win over people through friendship and not through muscle flexing. Many countries do it, but believe me, that is not sustainable. You can look at the history. All those who expanded through muscle flexing did not survive beyond a point. And all those who went through affection and love, everybody tried to destroy them, but they're still there, right? So are we there, and we shall always be there. And that is the message. Please approach these countries with warmth, with open hands. They are your friends. They will always remain your friends.